Hello and welcome to Your Voice with Senator Greg Ball. I'm your host, Brittany O, and of course, we're joined by Senator Ball.
Hey, how are you?
Wonderful. How are you?
Good.
And we are also joined by our special guest today. He is, let me see if I can get this title right, the Executive Deputy Commissioner of the New York State Division of Homeland Security and Emergency Services.
You got it.
But that's not it. He is also the Director of the Office of Emergency Management.
That's
Steve
correct.
Kuhr. He's newly appointed today, sworn in, right?
Sworn in today
Very
at 4
exciting.
O'clock.
A lot of responsibility on these shoulders.
Yeah, lots going on. Well, I'm happy to be here, Senator.
Thank you. Good having you.
So let's start off by talking. We've had a lot of issues in our district in particular with flooding and storm issues. What have some of your concerns been, Senator Ball, with what we've seen in the last year?
You know, with the natural disasters, I think we've seen throughout the state that first, when the you know what hits the fan, you have a natural disaster like that, it's the volunteers, it's the men and women in the EMS, the EMTs, the folks that are part of those emergency response services, the firemen, men and women, and the law enforcement personnel that really are out there doing the work that needs to be done and keeping us all safe. And then a lot of really great just community volunteers, people that come together from all angles. You know, that said, I think that the natural disasters have given us a window into the opportunity that we can do better. Mm-hmm. And we've got to make sure that we are better prepared leading up to an event like that, that we're not taken by surprise, whether it be a tropical storm or a snowstorm. Our utilities certainly have proven on some levels that they can do a much better job at communicating directly with folks and letting them know. There's a lot of misinformation and wrong information, which is, it's almost better sometimes to not know than to be given out bad information, because that just creates a lack of confidence. And people were pretty upset, I mean, during both, natural disasters. So there's new leadership out there. We have engaged the utility companies in a communication about how to improve moving forward. Mm-hmm. And I know that you have been going throughout the state, and what have you been hearing?
Well, with regard to your district in particular, I mean, you're very flood prone there, and flooding is the number one natural hazard in the state. When the governor asked the commissioner and I to take these appointments, it was with the images of Hurricane Irene and Tropical Storm Lee in mind. And one of the things I've been doing, Senator, as you indicated, is traveling the state, meeting with the county emergency management directors. In fact, we had a very, very comprehensive regional meeting in your area just about 3 weeks ago. And we met with about 10 emergency management directors at the county, city, town level, and the authorities like the Port Authority, mm-hmm. the MTA, West Point was represented. And we're hearing that they're deeply concerned about the potential for flooding this coming spring. They're deeply concerned about the potential for tornadoes this coming spring. And there's always the terrorism backdrop on their mind.
Right.
And the issues seem to transcend the counties and the regions throughout the state.
I know that we did a roundtable, and mm-hmm. I think you're going to show some shots of that with the new commissioner, Jerome Hauer, mm-hmm. who you have a very good working relationship with. And certainly it's the same issues, and we... You hear a lot of concerns from a funding perspective as well. I mean, it was our emergency response services that seemed to be pretty well funded in the aftermath of 9/11. Folks seem to wake up at this point and realize since that time, in my opinion, at least, the Federal Department of Homeland Security has left a lot to be desired in the way that they allocate funds. It seems to become a pork purveyor for states at much less security risk. And we've got to fight more on that front. Are you hearing concerns on that front as far as from a funding perspective?
We are. In fact, the president's budget was just released a couple hours ago, and we're getting briefed later this afternoon by the Secretary of Homeland Security and FEMA director on what potential grant opportunities are going to look like. Full grant guidance is due out from the federal government later in the week, but we're deeply concerned because we're hearing rumors of, for New York State, possibly 40%, maybe 40% plus cuts in Homeland Security funding. And that's critical because while the pendulum has swung from 2001, where terrorism was the critical threat, this flood event, Hurricane Irene, yeah. Tropical Storm Lee, Senator, where we had 38 counties declared a disaster. Imagine that we had a hurricane on the Canadian border. We know that our counterparts at the towns and the counties, they use the Homeland Security money to help support first response, and that's the backbone of funding for firefighters, EMS, right. and police personnel downrange.
I mean, at the end of the day, people have, I think that what we have seen happen at a federal level is that through the federal Department of Homeland Security and the creation of the Department of Homeland Security, there are many states that want to gain access to those grant dollars. And you have to really look, I think we've got to do a better job as a state to communicate the fact that on most days we're terrorist target number one. While we have to do everything we can to protect all the citizens of the United States, we have finite resources, especially during these tough economic times. We saw last year that on the congressional side, they tried to cut about $186 million in funding at that time. That was directly pointed mostly at the metropolitan area in New York City, which would have been absolutely devastating. We have to focus on the soft underbelly of this country, whether it be New York City or D.C., the metropolitan area, our ports. If you look through the list of grants that are granted to places like Kansas and Oklahoma, God bless them, got to do their job and their mission, no doubt about it. And then when you meet with first responders that either are in the metropolitan region, in the adjoining suburbs, which needs to be an area of key concern. We saw the bombings in Spain and how the suburbs were basically used as a funneling mechanism, as those transportation corridors. And you meet with these first responders and they're not prepared to the way they need to be because of a lack of dollars on the training side, or they're not properly equipped in the way that they need to be because of lack of resources. And now we're getting into these fights, even at the county level and the local level, where a lot of these services are being relegated to second or third class status on the matter of import.
It's a critical point you bring out. And last year, the federal government declassified the metro areas in the upstate part of New York as urban areas. So that, fortunately, the urban area grants will remain for New York City, but you're correct, Senator, that the first response community is deeply concerned about the reduction in the urban area grants because they are provided for training and equipment. And while the downstate part of New York might be viewed as the soft underbelly, the prime target, Buffalo is a metro area, Rochester, a tech sector, Syracuse as well. Yeah. And we're deeply concerned about our ability to provide a security and ongoing crisis preparedness for those communities as well. So we're going to have to, once we get our understanding of what the grant opportunities are going to look like this year, we may have to sharpen our pencils a little bit and tighten our belts.
For the first responders that are watching, can you explain a little bit about your background and Commissioner Howard's background and how you two have been, had such a great working relationship, and then maybe how the leadership is going to change a little bit and how they can communicate and get in touch with each of you to develop that relationship?
Absolutely. I'm happy to. The Commissioner and I have been working together for 26 years now. We met, we came together.
Most marriages.
It really is. We haven't really had any marital spats or divorces along the way, but our work has been fairly continuous. The Commissioner has a background in public health, public safety. He served as a State Director of Emergency Management in Indiana, City Director of Emergency Management in New York City. He was in the private sector in IBM, where he ran crisis management down in your neck of the woods.
Sure, yeah.
He was a captain in the Army, public health, he also served most recently at the federal level as Assistant Secretary of Health and Human Services for emergency preparedness. My background is in EMS, in New York City Fire Department. I started as an EMT. Became a paramedic, lieutenant captain, deputy chief of special operations. That's the nexus right there. When Jerry was doing emergency planning for EMS, I was doing it on the operational side, and we came together. And the rest, as they say, is history. He was asked to be, he was asked by Mayor Giuliani at the time to take appointment as director. He asked me to serve as deputy, and 15 years later, here we are still doing a very similar job.
So you have a perspective of the boots on the ground,
I do. As does Jerry. We have both boots on the ground and strategic level experience. And I think that's probably what makes us a good team. With him having worked in academia as well, which I didn't mention, as a professor for disaster management at George Washington University, as having been an assistant secretary, and me having been boots on the ground operations, muddy bloody, as they say. Mm-hmm. In New York City, I ran both operations and preparedness, so I was both running disaster management and disaster planning. So I think our skills together really complement each other and makes us a great team.
What are your priorities as far as the next 6 months, next year, next 5 years, and what assistance are you looking for? Have you guys figured it out yet?
We're just hit the 3 month mark, and as you mentioned, we're being sworn in today. The governor had to get all his commissioners in place. We've taken a magnifying glass to the organization, the Division of Homeland Security and Emergency Services, and I have taken a more focused look at the Office of Emergency Management. Right now, terrorism and security notwithstanding, we're taking a very focused approach to rebuilding emergency management, where over the course of the past few years, for attrition and budget cuts, the agency has been reduced in numbers and capacity. We cannot go into another tornado, flood, hurricane season. That's on the horizon.
Yeah.
At the reduced capacity that we're operating. So, in taking a very clear look at emergency management, we're rebuilding the organization. I've since appointed three deputy directors, one for operations, one for planning and preparedness, and one for recovery and mitigation. Very basic, very core emergency management construct, internal. I appointed internal professionals to support this. And now we're working with the Governor's Office and Division of Budget to restaff some of the divisions within the organization that have been reduced. In particular, we're very concerned about our field operation. Right now, we're structured in a five regional concept, or five regional emergency management directors. Some have deputies, some don't. That's based on attrition. These are individuals that work with elected officials, county emergency managers, fire rescue personnel, EMS personnel, police at the state and local level. And we're going to be increasing our regional footprint to have both a better span of control and shorter response time so we can get on the scene quicker and support our county, town, villages, and tribal partners in doing emergency management.
Yeah. Before we run out of time, I just want to also talk about cyber terrorism. That's a huge issue for both of you. We're going to actually be coming together and having a roundtable to discuss this issue. What are your concerns, both of you, about this happening? Because it is happening,
sure,
as we speak out there in other states. What do you see as the main concerns?
I can say it's extremely scary when you start to talk to the professionals in the field. As an Air Force Academy graduate, I have some friends of mine that are currently working in the private sector, and you hear certain things, to the tune of the fact that we believe that our Department of Defense systems, that some of them have been compromised. It's an operating given that some of these systems have been compromised. There are nation states that are actively engaging in stealing intellectual property, actually people going to work to break into the private sector and mm-hmm. steal that intellectual property, which there are real implications there, because once that information is stolen, there's a value there to the tune of either millions or billions of dollars. And then companies are not exactly likely to go out there and say that mm-hmm. this information has been breached for the effect on their stock and otherwise. And we certainly know from the Homeland Security perspective what the impact could be, whether it be a utility company or nuclear or anywhere in between, if those systems were compromised.
Right. I'm very concerned about it. You know, the cliche is that, you know, the next war will be fought on a cyber front. Mm. I think we're pretty close to that now. We're certainly in a cyber security crisis globally. I learned this morning that a very top secret federal agency, I'll leave it at that, was hacked over the weekend. Scary to think that an agency of this magnitude can be hacked. Tom Smith is our director of cybersecurity, and I'll love to loop him into the roundtable that you've discussed. But we're deeply concerned about denial of service attacks and the basic hackings that are going on, where they were able to release sensitive information. Certainly on the corporate side, as the senator mentioned, on the fiscal side, it's dramatic. But let me on the government security side, mm-hmm. the release of sensitive information is just very, very scary. Just about 6 months ago, one of the state fusion centers was hacked into, and they were releasing sensitive and classified documents to the public. So we have a real problem out there, and we have to address that as a society and as a profession.
Yeah. Good. Well, we're looking forward to the roundtable. It's all the time we have for this week, but we'll see you next week on Your Voice with Senator Ball.